Yesterday, at our regular Saturday morning ministers' meeting, Reverend Sonia Davidson shared with Reverend Michael Record and Shand and me that she had attended a recent reunion of her husband Winty's class or some function at Kingston College. And Reverend Sonia expressed her continued amazement and delight at the spirit of camaraderie, loyalty, togetherness, unity, and yes, love, expressed by former students of the school. Who are they, former KC students here? Can I see a show of hands? Yes, you all have something. Yes, Jennifer's hand is up because the women who support KC or are married to KC boys also are purple women. If you live in Jamaica or know KC former students in the diaspora, you will see love of the school expressed on bumper stickers, the school's royal purple color hung from the car rearview mirrors. I even attended a funeral at which the school tie was tied around the urn containing the ashes of the deceased. So deep and enduring is the love engendered at this school, it almost feels like a religion. In fact, when Hillary Clinton appeared in purple the day after the American election to make her concession speech, I said, "Lord, don't tell me she went to KC too." former President Clinton was also wearing a purple tie. So KC isn't mourning. They're very proud of their royal purple, trust me. Anyway, Reverends Anne, Michael, Sonia, and I agreed that it would be worthwhile to seek a fuller understanding of what it is that creates this powerful sense of community, this sense of belonging, of which KC is a striking example. But KC is not unique in this regard. Other schools, organizations, and institutions express this ethos of community, or as it came to me yesterday, common unity that creates a special bond between people of shared values. And so, I have titled my encouragement this morning, Community Equals Common Unity. I believe deeply that every voice can be heard. And I agree that one of the powerful factors in the sense of belonging that we're talking about, the sense of being a valuable and valid part of something meaningful and worthwhile, is something that we are also evidencing right here at this Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living. I'm seeing it here in our center as more and more people are evidencing a heightened enthusiasm to be involved in our mission of helping to create a world that works for everyone, not just as a spectator, but as a fully contributing part of this great truth movement started so many years ago by our beloved founder, Reverend Emma Lumsden, and being carried on by the people who attend this church. And you know, a lot of people come, and although they have not actually stood up to be members yet, they still feel like members, behave like members, contribute like members, so I include them in this. It's a family thing. It's the same thing that makes Jennifer Livingston say, put up her hand and say, "I'm a KC old boy." Well, not so old, but former student. I support, in other words, and subscribe to and embrace and embody the values expressed by this particular institution. And so, as I said, every voice can and must be heard in this center. And every gift that each of you brings to this community enriches everybody who comes through these doors. More and more people here at the temple are getting involved on every level, from volunteer work to prayer support, involved in our Love in Action ministries, making financial contributions, involved in leadership. I just want you all to know that you are deeply, deeply appreciated. And if you're one of those that just comes regularly, when I say just comes, I mean that you make a point of being here whenever you can be here, you are also contributing because you bring your consciousness of community, of common unity with you. So it's also a very important aspect of the vibrancy and the mission of this church. Another important aspect of creating common unity is the extent to which people express inclusion, or in other words, the extent to which people reach out. And I've been thinking a lot about reaching out because, you know, there are degrees of inclusion both wanted and inclusion expressed. So you have some people who don't have a need to be in everything. They just quietly come and they are here and they're supportive and they're with you, but they're not necessarily very loud in their support. Other people want to be in everything. And there are degrees of that, and it's all wonderful. There's no right or wrong. It means that people express at their level of feeling and understanding. But the inclusion expressed is a very interesting phenomenon. It's what makes people reach out and say, "Hi, I'm John. You've been coming here long? You know, every time I sit down over here and I look at you over there and I say, I don't even know your name. Who you be?" You know, kind of thing. So the science of mind teaches us that it is the law of life that we can only have what we first of all give, don't? This means that if you want love and friendship and you want to feel included and a part of something, you can't sit around saying, "I really want to feel a part of something." You have to do something, which I spoke about a few Sundays ago. Do something, and that something for me is to reach out however you wish to do it, in whatever fashion. Some people find it easier than others. How many of you find it difficult to initiate a conversation with a stranger? Can I see a show of hands? No, everybody here speaks to strangers all the time. Wow, only two people said, yes, me. Have you ever seen someone in a fabulous outfit and you've wanted to say, "You look terrific," but you held back from saying it because you didn't know how they were going to take it? You know, I remember once years ago, there was a lady in the bank standing in front of me, and she had her silver hair, beautiful silver gray hair, and I just love gray hair. So I said to her, "Excuse me, but your hair is like moonlight. It's so beautiful." And she looked around at me and said, "Hear me, Lord John, your mouth get you in trouble again." And she said, "Thank you, my love. You know, that son of a bitch I live with never even notice it." I met another gentleman in the supermarket who said, "What's your name?" So I said, "I'm John Scott." He said, "You are John Scott. You make it with my wife start back answer me, you know." You know what stops us from reaching out to people? It's fear. I don't know how they're going to react. I don't know if they, you know, what they will think. And it's fear of rejection. And you may say, "Well, it's not my nature. Or that, you know, I've been rejected before." And a lot of people tell me, "Well, I'm shy." But they also tell me, "But when I get to know you, I'm a different kettle of fish." So I don't know anybody who is really so shy that when they get with who they know and feel comfortable with, they can't, as we say in Jamaica, brook out. So my friends, each person that comes into your life is there because of the law of your being. Each person that comes into your life is there because of what you are vibrating and putting out, the way that you are expressing yourself. Dr. Ernest Holmes, the originator of this great teaching, explains it like this in the Science of Mind textbook. Quote, "In turning to the law, realize that it is a law of reflection." It's like looking in a mirror. And Dr. Elmer used to say, if you look in the mirror and your hair don't look good, don't comb the mirror. Dr. Holmes quotes Ralph Waldo Emerson, the 19th century American essayist, poet, and philosopher. Quote, "Life is the mirror of king and slave. If you want a friend, be a friend." Unquote. And Holmes further notes, and I quote, "As the idea of friendship dawns upon the consciousness, the law of attraction produces friends, for one is the picture, and the other is the thing. The key element in love, success, health, wealth, and common unity is believing in yourself enough to give out of that self, to contribute, to reach out to the moment and to everyone that is in that moment and to say, here am I, warts and all. You might not like what I have on. You might not like how I comb my hair. You might not like how I express myself. But here am I. I am God's child, and so are you. Wow, can you imagine if we could build that in this church? To just look past what the five senses can experience and see the love that's in every heart. That can see the beauty that is just resident in every single person. Then it just would just be such an enriching experience all the time. And I see it happening, and I'm just basking in it. So if you find it difficult to reach out to others, my friend, this church provides you with a safe, supportive environment in which to practice doing that. When you attend services, make a point of speaking with even one other person who you don't know. Early New Thought luminary and author, Dr. Tom Johnson, in his book Lessons from the Source, makes the point that to reach out in an assertive and positive way, you have to be assertive with yourself. You have to say, I'm going to reach out and make somebody feel blessed by meeting me today. He says that when you identify with who and what you really are, a beautiful expression of God, you are free to love yourself, to believe in that self, and to thus express it with authority, integrity, and deep love. What he is in effect saying is, treat yourself with respect and love, and there will be no difficulty in reaching out to others. Remember, it's not up to others to reach out to you. Just take responsibility, and you do the reaching out. You know, some of us, particularly we guys, we men, have problems expressing love, even to our own kids. There's a wonderful story told by Jean Medley in the first book, Chicken Soup for the Soul, that beautifully illustrates this. It's titled, Just Say It, and I want to share it with you. One night, after reading one of the hundreds of parenting books I've read, I was feeling a little guilty because the book had described some parenting strategies I hadn't used in a while. The main strategy was to talk with your child and use those three magic words. What are they? I love you. It had stressed over and over that children need to know unconditionally and unequivocally that you really love them. I went upstairs to my son's bedroom and knocked on the door. As I knocked, all I could hear were his drums. I knew he was there, but he wasn't answering. So I opened the door, and sure enough, there he was sitting with his earphones on, listening to a tape and playing his drums. After I leaned over and to get his attention, I said to him, Tim, have you got a second? He said, oh, sure, Dad, I'm always good for one. We proceeded to sit down, and after about 15 minutes and a lot of small talk and stuttering, I just looked at him and said, Tim, I really love the way you play drums. Oh, thanks, Dad, I appreciate it. I walked out the door and said, see you later. As I was walking downstairs, it dawned on me that I went up there with a certain message and had not delivered it. I felt it was really important to get back up there and have another chance to say these three magic words. What are they? Again, I climbed the stairs. Knocked on the door and opened it. You got a second, Tim? Sure, Dad, I'm always good for a second or two. What do you need? Son, the first time I came up here to share a message with you, something else came out. It really wasn't what I wanted to share with you. Tim, do you remember when you were learning how to drive? It caused me a lot of problems. I wrote three words and slipped them under your pillow in hopes that would take care of it, and that I had done my part as a parent, and that I had expressed my love to my son. Finally, after a little small talk, I looked at Tim and said, What I want you to know is that we love you. He looked at me and said, oh, thanks, Dad. That's you and Mom? I said, yeah, that's both of us. We just don't express it enough. He said, thanks, that means a lot to me. I know you do. I turned around and walked out the door. And as I was walking downstairs, I started thinking, damn, I can't believe this. I've already been up there twice. I know what the message is, and yet something else comes out of my mouth. I decided I'm going back up there now, and I'm going to let Tim know exactly how I feel. He's going to hear it directly from me. I don't care if he's 6 feet tall. So back I go. Knock on the door. And he yells, wait a minute. Don't tell me who it is. Could that be you, Dad? I said, how do you know that? And he responded, I've known you ever since you were a parent, Dad. Then I said, son, have you got just one more second? You know I'm good for one, so come on in. I suppose you didn't tell me what you wanted to tell me. I said, how did you know? He said, I've known you ever since I was in diapers. I said, well, here it is. Tim, what I've been holding back on, I just want to express to you how special you are to our family. It's not what you do, and it's not what you have done. It's like all the things you're doing with the junior high kids in town. It's who you are as a person. I love you. And I want you to know. What a amputation and a gut wrenching and a cut off one hand and one foot to say those three words. What are they? I love you. He looked at me and said, hey, Dad, I know you do. And it's really special hearing you say it to me. Thanks so much for your thoughts as well as the intent. As I was walking out the door, he said, oh, hey, Dad, have you got another second? I started thinking, oh no, what's he going to say to me? I said, oh sure, I'm good, I'm always good for one. I don't know where the kids get this. I'm sure it couldn't be from their parents, but he said, Dad, I just want to ask you one question. I said, what's that, son? He looked at me and said, Dad, have you been to a workshop or something? I'm thinking, oh no, like any other 18-year-old, he's got my number. And I said, no, I was reading a book and it said how important it is to tell your kids how you really feel about them. Hey, thanks for taking the time. Talk to you later, Dad, as he went back to his drums. And he concludes by saying, I think what Tim taught me more than anything else that night is that the only way you can understand the real meaning and purpose of love is to be willing to pay the price. You have got to go out there and risk sharing it. Dr. Holmes, writing about the law of attraction, notes that in order to have enduring and true friendships that are really worthwhile and beautiful, quote, we should cultivate an attitude of friendship toward everybody and everything, unquote. He says further, and I quote, the one who has learned to love all people will find plenty of people who return that love. This is not mere sentiment, and it is more than a religious attitude of mind. It is a deep scientific fact, and one to which we should pay attention. The reason is this. All is mind. And since we attract to us what we first become, until we learn to love, we are not sending out love vibrations. And not until we send out those vibrations can we receive love in return. Unquote. Friends, the master teacher and way shower, Jesus, gave us the secret to creating common unity in Matthew 22, verses 36 to 40. Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. What is it, my friends? Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And the Master says, on these two commandments hang all the law and prophets. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. And thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Can we say, I love the Lord that my God with all my heart? Can we say it? I love the Lord my God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my mind. And I love my neighbor as myself. My friends, as God is one, the law of love is the only law in our lives, and we fulfill it when we love both the Creator and the creation. So let us just say, the great love which I now feel for the world is the love of God together. The great love which I now feel for the world is the love of God. I reach out and offer it freely. I reach out and offer it freely. I uplift, therefore I am uplifted. I uplift, therefore I am uplifted. And now all that I give is reflected back to me. And now all that I give is reflected back to me. I love this one. God in me is unified with God in all.
God in me is unified with God in all.
To your neighbor say, God in you is unified with God in all. Thank you for sharing in our common unity.
God in me is unified with God in all. Thank you for sharing in our common unity.
Friends, God in you is unified with God in all. Thank you for sharing in our common unity. Have I forgotten something? What? Aha! Your mission. And I'm going to take a leaf out of Reverend Anne's book. I'm not asking you whether you decide to undertake it or no. This is your instruction today. After this service, speak to someone that you haven't spoken to before, or I don't know their name, or don't know. Just give them your name and get theirs and give them a hug and say, God in me salutes the God in you. Can we do that?
Yes.
Great. So, namaste.